Welcome, pre-cal students, to the homework help video or the review sheet help video. Let's go ahead and get started with the problems today. Here we go. Okay, students, for numbers 1, 3, and 5, the directions say to evaluate the expression, approximate your result to three decimal places. So we're just practicing how to use your calculator here. So in your calculator, you would type in 6.1. Then hit the arrow button, and when you hit the arrow button like this, a parenthesis should pop up. I'm wrong, a parenthesis does not pop up, so go ahead and put a parenthesis, and then type in 2.4, close your parentheses, and you should get 76.6993, so 699. 76.699. Okay, moving on to number 3. We're going to type in 2. This will be our exponent right here. So type in 2, then arrow, then parentheses, then negative 0.5, and there's a pi button. If you'll look at the far right column, on the right side, the very far right column, the word clear is up top. The word clear, right below that button, is the button that says arrow. And then look right above it, there's a little pi right here, okay? So hit second, and then this button right here, and pi will pop up right here, okay? So I'm going to go ahead and type that in to my calculator. 2 arrow parentheses negative 0.5, and then pi, excuse me, sorry, and then enter, and you will get this right here, 0.3366. We'll make this a 7, 0.337, okay? All right, over here, we're going to type in 60, then arrow, and then square root. And then type in 3, and then close the parentheses, okay? So 60, arrow, square root of 3, enter, and you will get this for your answer, 1201.8445. So if you round it correctly, you get 845. Okay, moving on to the next section here, 11 through 17, the directions say to graph. Okay, now let's start with this one right here, and I'm sorry, they're coming up a little hard to read. This is a negative x right here. 4 to the negative x plus 4, okay? Well, this is called an exponential function. It's called an exponential function because you have an unknown in the exponent right here, okay? So what I taught you to do when you're graphing exponential functions is you take the exponent, you set it equal to 0, and you solve. Divide both sides by a negative 1, you get this. That goes in the middle of your table of values, okay? So we'll put a 0 in here, and we'll go up 1, 2, and we'll go down. Okay, next, remember every exponential function has a horizontal asymptote. Please don't forget that, okay? And the horizontal asymptote is always at your constant term. Your constant term, okay? If there is no constant term, then 0. We have a constant term here of 4. So we have a horizontal asymptote at 4, okay? Now, don't forget, students, to fill in your table of values here. You can type this whole expression here into your calculator, okay? So with your calculator, go ahead and hit Y equals button, top left, and then type into your calculator. Well, first of all, go to the zoom button, top middle button, zoom, then hit 6. Okay, now go ahead, Y equals, and type in 4, and then arrow, and then negative X, parentheses, negative X, like this. Close your parentheses, and then plus 4, okay? Like that. And now go to your table of values on the far right top button is your graph button, hit second graph, and your table of values will pop up, okay? And here's what I'm getting to is, two is 4.1. One would be 4.3. Of course, I'm rounding those. Zero would be 5. Negative 1 would be 8. And negative 2 would be 20. Now, guys, I'm not going to plot these points for you. You're big pre-cal students. I will do this. I will put the horizontal asymptote on here for you. The horizontal asymptote would be right here in red, running through 4. Okay? And your graph will be above that line. Your graph will be somewhere up here. Okay, I'm not going to plot these points for you here. That's easy math. That's middle school math to do that, okay? So I'll plot those 5 points, and you'll have the graph, okay? Moving on to number 11. Number 11. Let me get a drink here real quick. And here we go. X plus 1 right here, students. There we go. Okay, for number 13, please notice that there's no constant term. This is your base right here. And this is your exponent right here. So if there's no constant term, then we're going to go ahead and put plus 0. Okay? So your horizontal asymptote will be at 0. Now, take your table of values, set it equal, take your exponent, set it equal to 0, and solve. And that gives you your negative, that gives you your middle value on your table of values. Okay? So a negative 1 here, so I'll go to 0 and 1 here, and then negative 2 and negative 3. Now, with your calculator, go ahead and type this into your calculator, okay? So y equals, I'm going to clear out my old equation. I'm going to type in negative 2.65, arrow, and then parentheses, and then x plus 1. And now if you're doing that correctly, you should get this right here. You should get a negative 0.14 for negative 3. And you should get negative 0.38. Negative 2. Negative 1 should give you negative 1. 0 should be negative 2.65. And 1 should give you out negative 7.02. Okay? Now I'm not going to graph that for you. Plotting these points right here is something that we do in middle school. It's pretty easy to do. But the asymptote I will put on here for you. The asymptote will be right here at 0. So there's your horizontal asymptote, okay? And the graph would be somewhere below this line down here, below the horizontal asymptote, okay? All right, moving on to number 15. All right, guys, number 15 here. It is x minus 2. There we go. Now your constant term is plus 4. So your horizontal asymptote would be at 4. Okay. Take your exponent, set it equal to 0, and solve. So your middle value will be 2. I really need to work on my straight lines here, don't I? They're pretty bad. 0, let's see, going up here would be 2. 3, 4, going down would be 1 and 0. Now go ahead and type this into your calculator. Type 5, and then arrow, then parentheses, x minus 2, and then close your parentheses, and then plus 4. So here we go. Let's see, 5, arrow, parentheses, x minus 2, close the parentheses, plus 4, and now go to my table of values. And here we go. 4 is going to be 29. 3 would be 9. 2 would be 5. 1 would be 4.2. And 0 would be 4.04. Now, I'm not going to plot these points for you. That's old AC math, but I will put the horizontal asymptote on here for you. It said 4. So the horizontal asymptote would be right here. And your graph would be up here somewhere above the horizontal asymptote. Okay, moving on to number 17. One half to the negative x plus 3. Let me check and make sure that's right. Yeah. Okay, so your constant term is 3, which means your horizontal asymptote will be at 3. Okay, now take your exponent here, set it equal to 0 and solve. So your middle value will be 0. Okay, so we'll put a 0 right here, we'll go up, and we'll go down. Now, type this into your calculator, be very careful. Whether you use 1 half or whether you use 0.5, either way, use parentheses, okay? I'm going to put into my calculator parentheses 0.5, close the parentheses, arrow, parentheses, negative x, close the parentheses, and then plus 3 like that, okay? All right, here we go. Let's take a look at this. Parentheses 0.5, close the parentheses, arrow, negative x, close the parentheses, plus 3. And here we go. We will get out for negative 2. We would have a 3.25. Negative 1 would be 3.5. 0 would be 4. 1 would be 5. And 2 would be 7. Okay? Now, I'm not going to take the time to plot these points for you. That's pretty much easy math. But I will show you where the horizontal asymptote is. Okay? Here we go. There we go, up 3, and your horizontal asymptote would be right here at 3. Okay? And you would be above, your graph would be up here somewhere. Okay? Alright, there we go, moving on to number 19. Alright, number 19, let me get a drink here real quick. Numbers 19 and 21, the directions say to evaluate it to 3 decimal places. And I'm really sorry about the quality of some of these pictures here, guys. I apologize. They will get better as the video goes along. That's e to the 8, and the other one is e to the negative 1.7. Okay, here we go. E to the 8. If you look to the left of your calculator, the very left column, fourth button from the bottom. You'll see this button right here. Right above that, though, you'll see this. So you want to hit shift or second, and then this button right here. So this will pop up right here. E, arrow, parentheses, and then type in 8. Okay? And you will get this right here for your answer. 2980.9579, so 958. Okay? Alright, now this one here, hit your second and then your LN button, and this will pop up. This will pop up right here. So there we go. And then type in negative 1.7. Close the parentheses. And this will be your answer right here. 0.1826, so 0.183. All right, okay, moving on. Okay, we're going to graph these exponential functions here. So here we go. Now, students, the only difference between these problems here and the ones back here that we graphed is here your bases were 4 and 2.65 and 5 and 1/2. Here your bases are e's, but nothing really changes, so it's still done the same way. For example, number 23 has no constant term, so I'm going to put plus 0. So my horizontal asymptote will be at 0. Okay, now take your exponent, set it equal to 0 and solve. Okay, multiply both sides by 2, And now divide both sides by negative 1. And there's your middle value right there. Okay? So 0 goes right in the middle. Now, remember when you type this into your calculator, go to your Y equals button, top left, your little button that says Y equals. Go ahead and push that button, and then type in, hit second, and then LN button, and when you do that, this will pop up. And then type in a negative sign, then X, then hit divided by, and then 2, and then close your parentheses. Okay, and you're all set. Go ahead and go to your table of values. And let's see what we have here for negative 2. We get 2.72. For negative 1, we'll get 1.65. For 0, we will get out a 1. For 1, we will get out a 0.61. And for 3, for 2, we will get out 0.37. Okay, now I'm not going to plot these points for you, students. You know how to do that, but however, I will show you where the horizontal asymptote is. The horizontal asymptote is 0, so it would fall right here on top of the x-axis. Okay, and your graph would be above the green line up here. Like that, okay? All right, moving on to number 25. Okay, students, let's go ahead and continue on to number 25 here. Number 25. Okay, there's no constant term, so we're going to put plus 0. So my horizontal asymptote would be at 0. Now take your exponent, set it equal to 0, and solve. So my middle value would be negative 2 on my table of values. Okay? So negative 2 right in the middle. Now type this here into your calculator, okay? So here we go. Second natural log, and this will pop up. And then type in x plus 2, and then close the parentheses. Values, and here we go. For negative 4, you will get 0.14. Of course, I'm rounding all of these. Negative 3 is 0.37. Negative 2 is 1. Negative 1 is 2.72. And 0 is 7.4. Okay, there we go. So I'm not going to take the time, students, and plot all these points for you here. However, I will show you where the horizontal asymptote would be. And the horizontal asymptote would be at negative 2. This is the x-axis right here. It would be right here, okay? And your graph would be up here somewhere. Okay? Alright, moving on to number 27. Okay, we're going to complete the table to determine the balance A for P dollars invested at rate R for T years. So here we go. If you look carefully, N equals 4. That means your money is going to be compounded every year. How many times? 4 times, okay? So here's our formula right here. Now, your principal, what you're investing is $3,500. Your rate R would be 0.065. Move the decimal to place. place was to the left. Your N would be 4. And your power would be N, excuse me, would be 4 times 10. Because your time is 10 years. T. Now, guys, the first thing I would do is I would make all of this here become a decimal, okay? That's what I would do. So bring down your 3,500. And then with your calculator, I would type in 1 plus 0.065 divided by 4. Enter. And here's what you come up with. And then multiply 4 times 10, your power would be 40. Now remember, students, please don't forget, you do not multiply these two numbers here first. Okay, that's wrong. If you do that, you will get the wrong answer. So you enter your power first. So take this number here to the 40th power. And then multiply it times 3,500. And if you do that correctly, you will come up with this right here. 6,669.46. Okay, so you started off with 3,500. 10 years later, you have this much money here. So how much money did you gain? You gained this much. You gained $3,169.46. Okay, that's how much you gained. And here's your balance at the end, okay? And this is the answer they were looking for right here, okay? There's your answer. All right, moving on to number 29. Okay, students, for number 29, the directions say to complete the table to determine the amount P that should be invested to have a balance of 200,000. So now we're kind of going backwards. Well, first of all, students, please notice that we're dealing with compound continuously, okay? So your formula is this right here, okay? Secondly, they're giving us the amount of money they want you to have at the end, okay? So they want you to have 200,000 at the end. That's your ending amount. So P is what you're solving for. Now your rate is 0.08, and your T is 20 years. Now, first of all, I would multiply these two together here. So you have just one exponent, okay? So 0.08 times 20 would give you 1.6. So now I have this right here. Now, remember, E is an actual number. So next, to get P by itself, I would divide both sides by E to the 1.6 power, like this. Okay? So these cancel here, and I'm left with P. So with my calculator now, I'm going to type in 200,000 divided by E to the 1.6 power. And I will get this right here. 40,379.30 or 0.30. Okay? So this here, students, is the amount of money that you would want to start off with to put into your bank account so that after 20 years has passed, you would then have $200,000. Okay? I hope that makes sense. Let's continue on to number 31. Number 31. Okay, the average time between incoming calls to the switchboard is 3 minutes. The probability of waiting less than 10 minutes until the next incoming call is approximated by this model right here. If a call has just come in, find the probability that the next call will be within 2 minutes, okay? So really, all that you're doing is where T is right here. You're simply substituting 2, okay? That's all that this model does for you, okay? You simply put a number in that represents minutes, and you get out the probability that you get out the probability that a phone call will come in within the next 2 minutes, okay? So here we go. 1 minus e to the negative 2 over 3. So students, it's really just a calculator problem, okay? Type in 1 and then minus, and then second natural log, and this will pop up right here. And then type in 2 divided by negative 2 divided by 3, and then close your parentheses. Hit enter and you will get this right here. The probability is 0.49. If you round correctly, 0.49. Okay? Right, moving on to the next problem. Number 33. On the day a person was born, a deposit of $50,000 was made in a trust fund that earns 8.75 interest compounded continuously. Find the balance on the person's 35th birthday, okay? Okay, students, so here we go. First of all, the formula for compounded continuously is this right here. Now, let's see, we want to find the balance after 35 years have gone by. So, my principal is 50,000. That's how much I invested. My rate would be 0.0875. Yeah, my time would be 35, okay? So with my calculator, I'm going to type in 0.0875 times 35, and I'll get this right here, 3.0625, okay? So now type this whole thing into your calculator. So I would type in 50,000, and then second natural log, and then 3.0625, enter, and you'll get this right here. You will get 1 second, guys. I think I made a mistake here. Okay, students, I'm back. I was a little confused on something, but we've done nothing wrong. The amount of money is this right here. And here's where I was confused at. Hold on 1 second here. I was confused because it said here how much longer we have to wait to get twice as much. And I thought they were asking how long would he have to wait to double this and get 100,000. And if you look, he's already at 1 million. Okay? But what it meant was, is how much longer will he have to wait to double this? Okay? So the question is, he's already waited how many years? 35 years for it to go from here to here. From 50,000 to 1 million. 69. So, how long would he have to wait for this to double? So here's what you do. Slide this over here. Take this right here. And multiply it by 2. So if you multiply it by 2, you get this right here. You get 2,138,094.28. So that's how much money he wants to have, okay? So here's what you do, guys. It's so easy. Just take this amount here and put it in for A. Because now you want this to be your ending amount. So that's your A. Your principal is 50,000. Okay? And then E to the R, T. So find the time. Find the time that's going to take you to get from here to here. Okay? And then we'll go from there. So, here we go. We're going to solve for T. So, divide both sides by 50,000. Okay? If you do that correctly, you will get 42 point. So I'm going to make it pretty long. 761885 equals e to the 0.0875t. Now, guys, you're solving for an exponent, so we're going to take log base e of both sides. Okay? So we'll take the log base e of this side here, and we'll take the log base e of this side over here. Okay? Now, on the right side, this will cancel, leaving you with 0.0875t. And over here, log base e is natural log. So I'm going to take the natural log of this number right here, 42.76185. And I will get this right here, 3.75565. And then divide that by 0.0875. And I will get this right here, 42.9. So I'm going to say 43. So, now guys, think about this. He's already rated 35 years. But if he'll just wait, how many more years? 8 more years. It will then be a total of 43 years. And it will double his money. Okay? So, how much longer would he have to wait to double it? 8 more years. And this money right here would double to this right here. Okay? Alright, moving on. Okay, students, moving on. Number 37. The directions A2. Write this in logarithmic form, okay? So here's the model I gave you guys. The model I gave you guys is this. Okay? So look at your model right here. Whatever is all by itself, B64, that's what you're taking the logarithm of. So we have log of 64, okay? Now, here's 4, it's the base, okay? Here's A, it's the base. Where does A go? That's the base over here. So 4 goes here, and then equals C. Here's your exponent. Your exponent's 3. So equals 3. So this here is the exact same expression as this here, okay? All right, numbers 39 through 42. We're going to solve these without using a calculator, okay? So here's number 39. Set it equal to x, write it exponentially. Now try to write both sides with the same base. So this would be 10 to the third power, because 10 times 10 is 100, times 10 is 1,000. And now look, your bases are the same, so cross them off and set these equal. And there's your answer, 3 equals x. Okay. Okay, number 40 right here. Log base 9 of 3 equals x. Okay, let's write it exponentially. And then we want to write both sides with the same base. Okay, so 9 became 3 squared. Now, whenever you have a power raised to a power, we would have 2 times x. So 2x. Now, students, what's the power over here, or the exponent over here? Even though you can't see it, it's a 1. Cross off your like bases. Set these equal. So 1 equals 2 to the x. Divide both sides by 2. And 1/2 equals x. So there's your answer. Okay, moving on to number 41. Log base 2 of 1/8 equals x. Now we're going to write this exponentially, okay? So 1/8 equals 2 to the x. Now we're going to try to write both sides with the same base. So 8 can be rewritten as 2 to the third. Okay? Now bring this 2 to the third up top, and I have 2 to the negative 3 equals 2 to the x. Okay? Now your bases are the same, so cross off your like bases, set these equal, and you have your answer, x equals negative 3. And then lastly, number 42. Okay, okay students, moving on to number 42. Log base a of 1 over a equals x. Okay, well here we go. Write this exponentially, so 1 over a equals a to the x power. Now, guys, what is the exponent of the 1 of the a? Even though you can't see it right here, it's a 1. So if you bring the a up top, this 1 right here becomes a negative 1. So I have a to the negative 1 equals a to the x. Cross off your like bases, set your exponents equal, and there's your answer right there. X equals negative 1. Okay? All right, moving on. Number 43. Okay, the directions say to graph these. So here we go. Now we're graphing a logarithmic function, okay? Here's what I've taught you. Whenever you're graphing a logarithmic function, the first thing you do is take the argument and set it equal to 0. So in number 43, the argument is x. So set it equal to 0. And that will be your and solve, and that is your vertical asymptote, okay? So your vertical asymptote will be a 0 right here. All logarithmic functions have a vertical asymptote, okay? Now remember, guys, all exponential functions have a horizontal asymptote. All logarithmic functions have a vertical asymptote, okay? So, take the argument, set it equal to 0, and solve as your vertical asymptote. Now, next, remember, if this is your vertical asymptote, then you got to ask yourself, is my graph going to be over here? Or is my graph going to be over here? Well, use common sense, guys. There's no way it's going to be over here. There's no way. If you put a negative 2 in for x, you can't take the logarithm of a negative 2. You can't take the logarithm of 0 or a negative 2. Either one. So, I know my graph has to be over here to the right. So, here's what I'm going to do. For my table of values, I'm going to go barely past the asymptote. I'm going to put 0.1. And then I'm going to put 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay? So with my calculator, I'm going to go ahead and put these numbers in. So for x right here, I'm going to put 0.1. So very quickly, I'm going to type in the log of 0.1, enter, divided by the log of 7. Enter. And I'm going to get negative 1.12. Or negative 1.2. Okay, now students will quickly put these numbers in here. And so I'll do that quickly here. It would be the log of, we'll put a 1 right here for x. So it'd be log of 1, enter, divided by log of 7. We get 0. Logarithm of 2, enter, divided by log of 7. And we get 0.36. And for 3, we have log of 3, enter, divided by log of 7. 0.56. And then for 4, we have log of 4, enter, divided by log of 7. 0.71. So I'm not going to plot these for you, but I guess I can plot them really quickly for you. If you can barely go over, let's see, 1, 2, 3, if you barely go over, you'll be at negative 1.2. And then 1 would be at 0. 2 is at 0.36. About right here. 3 is a 0.5 and 4 is a 0.7. so you get a pretty good idea of what it looks like. Okay, there we go. And the graph will not cross your vertical asymptote. Okay, all right, moving on. Number 45. Okay, your argument is x over 3. So take x over 3 equals 0. Multiply both sides by 3, and you will get x equals 0 for your vertical asymptote. Okay, so here's your coordinate plane down here. And then your vertical asymptote will be right here at 0. Okay, there's your vertical asymptote. Now, would I go this way in the graph? Or this way? Well, think about it, guys. If you put a negative 1 in for x right here, that would give you a negative 1/3. And there's no way you can take the logarithm of negative 1/3. So, we're going to have to go to the right of the graph. So my table of values would look something like this. It would barely to the right, so 0.1, then 1, 2, 3, 4. And notice, thankfully, this is a base 10, and your calculator does base 10 for you. So just hit log of 0.1 divided by 3. And make sure that 0.1 divided by 3 is in parentheses. Then hit enter, and you'll get negative 1.5. Now put 1 in for x. So logarithm of 1 divided by 3, enter. Negative 0.48. Negative 18.18. Then put a 3 in for x. So log of 3 over 3 gives you 0. And then log of 4 would give you 0.60. So very quickly, at 0.1, it would be at negative 1.5, and at 1 would be at negative 0.48, at 2, negative 0.1, at 3, 0, at 4, 0.6. So the graph would look something like this. Okay, there we go. On to number 47. Okay, take your argument, which is x plus 5, and set that equal to 0. So x plus 5 equals 0. Go ahead and solve that. And there is your vertical asymptote right there. Vertical asymptote. So we'll come down here and draw this. Your vertical asymptote at negative 5. Now here's the question, students. The question is does my graph go over here or over here? Well, let's find out. If I were to put a negative 6 in for x, a negative 6 right here, a negative 6 plus 5 would give me a negative 1, and I cannot take the logarithm of a negative number. So my graph has to be over here to the right. So barely go past your vertical asymptote. Go past it a little bit. So we're at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So negative right here, guys. This is negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 4. If I get real close here, it's going to be negative 4.9. And then continue going this way. Up negative 4, negative 3, negative 2, negative 1. So here we go, students. Here we go. Let's put negative 4.9 in real quick. So I'm going to type into my calculator 4 minus, and thankfully it's a base 10. Makes it easier. So 4 minus log of negative 4.9 plus 5. Close the parentheses, enter, and I'll get 5. Now we'll try negative 4, okay? So, let me give you a 4. Now we'll try negative 3. 3.7. Now we'll try negative 2. 3.5. Now we'll try negative 1. And we'll get 3.4. So here we go. Negative 4.9. Negative 4.9 is way up here at 5. And then negative 4, we're at 4. Negative 3 would be 3.7. Negative 2 would be 3.5. So it looks like the graph looks something like this. Now, students, if you look, it kind of looks like there's an asymptote here at 3, horizontal. But that is not the case, okay, if you'll continue. If you continued to put numbers in, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, you will see that this graph here, even though it's very, very gradually, is continuing as it goes to the right. It is still getting lower and lower and lower, okay? The only asymptote would be the vertical asymptote right here, okay? That's the only asymptote that you would have, okay? All right, guys, moving on. Number 49, okay? These are all calculator problems, so break out your calculators, and here we go. First of all, the natural log of 22.6. So we're going to type natural log, and then 22.6, enter, and we'll get this right here. And I think we're rounding to 3 decimal places, so 3.1179. So 3.118. Okay. Alright, natural log of e to the negative 12. Well, guys, we don't need a calculator for this one. We know this. Natural log here means log base what? E of e to the negative 12. Well, look, whenever your base here matches your base here, the entire answer is your exponent. So the answer is negative 12. Now, if you want to take the time to type this whole thing here into your calculator, you can do that. It's fine. But you will get out negative 12. Okay? And then here with this problem here, go ahead and hit natural log. And when you do, the parentheses pops up right away. Then hit square root of 7. And when you hit square root, another parentheses pops up like this. Put 7 and then close the parentheses. And then hit plus 5 and close the parentheses. And you will get this for your answer. 2.0341. So, 2.034. Okay? All right, moving on to number 55 and 57. I think we are graphing these. Yes, we're graphing them. So, here we go. First of all, students, remember, you take the argument and you set the argument equal to 0. So right here, your argument is x. Now, students, your argument is not x plus 3. It is not. If your argument was x plus 3, then there would have been parentheses around x plus 3, and there's not. Your argument is just x. Take your argument, set equal to 0, and that will be your vertical asymptote. OK.
we go. Now,
the question is, are we going to go to the right or are we going to go to the left? Okay, well, there's no way we're going to go to the left. If you go to the left, you have to put negative 1 in for x. If you put a negative 1 in for x, you're taking the logarithm of a negative number, and we can't do that. So, we know we're going to go to the right. So here we go. I'm going to the right. We're going to put in 0.1. And 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? And here we go. Natural log of 0.1. So natural log 0.1. And then be sure and close your parentheses, guys. So look, when you hit natural log, up pops a parentheses. Okay? When you put x in, be sure and close the parentheses and then hit plus 3. Okay? Very important. Very important. And you'll get this, 0.697. Now we'll put 1 in for x. So natural log of 1. Natural log of 1, be sure and close the parentheses, and then plus 3. Okay, natural log of 1, close the parentheses, plus 3, gives you 3. Okay, and then natural log of 2, close the parentheses, plus 3.7, and then natural log of 3, close the parentheses, plus 3, 4.099, and then put a 4 in, so the natural log of 4, and close the parentheses, plus 3, 4.4. So students, here we go, okay? 4.1, I'm going to go to 0.6, 0.7, for 1, I'm going to go to 3, for 2, 3.7, for 3, about 4, and for 4, about 4.4. Okay, all right, there we go. We've got the number 57. Okay, we're going to take the argument here. X squared. And set it equal to 0 and solve. So here we go. Take the square root of both sides. Square root of x squared is x square root of 0, 0. Okay, so the vertical asymptote will be 0. Right here. Okay, there we go. Now, next, we've got to decide whether or not we're going to go to the right or to the left. Okay, now on this one here, it's interesting. On this one here, think about it, guys. If you put in a 1, and you square the 1, you get a positive number. But look, if you put in a negative 1 and square it, you get out 1. So we're going to have a graph on both sides of the vertical asymptote. Okay? We're going to have a graph over here, and we're going to have a graph over here. It's going to be really, really weird. Okay? So here we go. Watch this carefully, please. Oh, here we go. Now, let's go ahead and start working on the right side first over here. So my table of values would look like this. Go barely past the asymptote. Go barely past it, 0.1. Then 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? So, we put 0.1 in here, and we're going to square. 2 in. 2 times 2 is 4. So the natural log of 4 is 1.4. Okay? Now, put a 3 in for x. 3 squared is 9. So we're going to take the natural log of 9. And that would be 2.20. And put a 4 in. Square the 4 is 16. So the natural log of 16 would be 2.77. Okay? So there we go. Now, let's go ahead and go across here. Let's go up. If you go over 0.1, you go down negative 4.6. 1 is 0. 2 is 1.4. 3 is 2.2. And 4 is 2.7. So you see, hopefully, a little bit of a curve here, okay? Now, guys, look. Please listen to me. Think about this for a second, okay? If you put it at negative 0.1 and square it, okay? A negative 0.1 squared is going to give you a positive. You'll get the exact same number out. If you put a negative 1 in and square it, you get out 1, and the natural log of 1 is 0. If you put a negative 2 in and square it, you'll get out 4. And that's the natural log of 4, which is 1.4. So in other words, go ahead and try. If you don't believe me, go ahead and try this. Go ahead and put in these negative numbers in for x. And when you do that, be sure and square them like you're supposed to, okay? And when you do that, when you square them, you will see you get out the exact same number over here for y. So what you have is a reflection. It's a mirror image, okay? So you have a point here, then a point here, and then a point here. Then here, and then about here, okay? So there we go, okay? Pretty simple, all right? Okay, moving on to number 59. The number of miles S of roads cleared of snow is approximated by this model here. H is the depth of the snow in inches, and S is the number of miles of roads cleared, okay? So, use this model to find S when H is 10. So guys, all that you're doing is simply putting 10 in here, and then typing this whole thing into your calculator, okay? So here's how I would do this. I would first of all take the natural log of 10 divided by 12. So I would type in this whole numerator right here. I would type in 13 natural log 10 divided by 12 and close your parentheses, okay? That's what I would do. So 13 natural log 10 divided by 12. And I'm gonna put the whole thing. It'd be negative 2.37 0180238, okay, divided by the natural log of 3. So natural log of 3 is 1.09861 2289. Now don't forget, there's a negative sign here in front, okay? Then 25. So now here's what you have, okay? I would type this in your calculator. I would type in 25, then hit minus, then hit parentheses for the entire fraction, and hit negative 2.37018. Then it would look like this. I would hit 25 minus parentheses negative 2.37018 divided by
1.09861.
Just like that, okay? And then hit enter. And there's your answer. 27, so there was 10 inches of snow. They had to clear 27.16 miles of roads. Okay, that's a lot. Okay. Let me check that in the back of the book and make sure we did that correctly real quick here. Yes, that is correct. Okay, moving on to number 61. Okay. Now, number 61 and 63, they just want us to type these into our calculators and solve them. That's it. So, with your calculator, you would simply hit log of 9, enter, divide it by log of 4, enter. And you will get this for your answer. Okay. Now, here you would type in log of 5, enter, divided by log of 1/2. Or log of 0.5, enter, and you will get negative 2.322. Okay, all right, moving on. 65. Okay, now here they want us to verify these statements by using properties. Okay, this is really easy to do, guys. It really is. Okay, now look. We know that when you're adding two logarithms, like we are here, we know that you can condense them down to one log as long as you multiply their arguments. So there we go, we're done. Pretty simple, okay. We have a choice here, guys. We are either going to take this expression here and expand it, or take this expression here and condense it. I really don't care, but I guess I'll take this here and I'll condense it down. So first of all, your 1/2 here out front is an exponent. So I really have this now. X to the 1/2 power, okay? And then your 3 becomes an exponent. Okay? Now, x to the 1/2 is the same thing as the square root of x. Okay? Now next, notice they're both base 8 and they're subtracting, so I can condense that down to one log. Log base 8. And whenever the two logarithms are subtracting, you can take their arguments and divide them. And there we go. We're finished. We did it. Okay. Number 69. Okay, now here, they want us to expand these as far as we can. So number 69, notice I have 5 times x. So I'm going to put log base 5 of 5 plus log base 5 of x squared, okay? Now next, look at this right here, guys. What is your power? Your power, your exponent right here is 1, okay? So whatever your base matches your base, these cancel out, you're left with 1. So I have 1 plus, and this 2 right here goes right here, so 1 plus 2 log base 5 of x. There we go. We took this and we expanded it. Okay, students, on to number 70, okay? Number 70. Okay, here we go. Now, first of all, notice we have an argument here that's being divided, okay? So I'm going to write log base 10 of 5 square root of y minus log base 10 of x squared, okay? Now, right here. Make it a little bigger and put it right here. Okay. Now, over here I have 5 times square root of y. So I'm going to take this logarithm here and split it up into two more logarithms. So now I have log base 10 of 5 plus log base 10 of the square root of y. Okay, now the square root of y is the same thing as y to the 1/2. Now this 1/2 can go out front right here, okay? And we should be finished. Done, guys. That's it. You know you're done because your argument here is just a 5. Your argument here is just a y, and your argument here is just an x. Okay? So you're finished. Okay, number 73. Okay, they want us to take this and condense it down. So here we go. We have 2 logarithms. They're being added right here. So write your logarithm once and multiply your arguments. That was really, really simple. Okay? Done. Alright, number 75. Okay, here we go. We have two logarithms are being subtracted. I'm gonna take some 1/2 here and put it right here. Take this 2 right here and put it right here. Okay. Now next, because they're being subtracted, I'm going to put the logarithm of, and up top here, I'm going to put 2x minus 1 to the 1/2 power all over x plus 1 squared. Let's do this 1/2 right here. Next, I'm going to put this. Students, we've done a pretty good job here. I want to say this to you. Let's go ahead and use some common sense here, okay? Just a little bit of common sense. Now, look at the numerator here. Guys, look. You have to leave the absolute values around this, okay? That's important. That's important. You can't just drop absolute values unless you have a reason. But look at the numerator, guys. Look, I don't care what you put in for x. A negative 1 or a negative 2 or a positive 1 or a positive 2, it doesn't matter. When it comes out of here, you're going to make it positive, right? But also, what else are you going to do to it? You're going to square it, right? So if you square a positive number or if you square a negative number, it doesn't matter. It still comes out positive. So you're more than welcome to leave your answer like this right here. That's fine. I have no problem with this. But you can also write your answer like this if you wanted to. You could write it like this. All over. And just put parentheses. Now, if you don't understand that, that's totally fine, okay? That is totally fine. But I'm just saying absolute values here is fine. But also, instead, you can put parentheses, because remember, whatever you get out of this, it's going to come out what? Positive. Because of the absolute values, and then you're going to do what to it? Square it, which will still give you out a positive number. Or you could look at it like this, whatever you get out of this here, it could be positive or negative. It doesn't matter, because at the end,
fine, but either one of these two answers